Hello, everyone. Firstly, thank you very much for booking in to hear me speak today. I am going to be talking about some things that are very difficult, but I would like you, when I speak, to view me as the younger me, but also it will bring it up to current day. So when I'm talking to you, I want you to think about the young people you work with and how they react in certain situations. What I've done is I've actually wrote a few notes, not because I don't know my own life, but it's just to, you know, make sure that I go in the right direction. Okay, so we all have a story. Some stories are filled with happiness, others are filled with pain. Pain of the heart and the mind can be the hardest pain to see or understand. We all deal with our pain differently. In some people, the pain can start to surface through anger, violence, depression, self-harm, drug and alcohol abuse, the list can go on. Others will bury their pain so deep within, we don't really get to see it. And there's many, many people walking around and we just don't realise their journeys and their stories. But we assume because they're functioning, because they're standing, as I am today, that you think they're okay. But it's only when you really take a deep look at people that you start to see many of us live in a lot of pain. Now, this is my story. So, my name's Alison, as you know. I was born in 1974, and I was actually born in Nigeria, which is in West Africa. I was very privileged. My mum, my dad, we were very well off. We had maids, and each of us had a private nanny. So we were spoilt, really. So we lived in wealth. We had many, many people that worked for the family. And so you would think, what an amazing life and what an amazing start this woman could have had. And at that time, that was true. Now, when I was 18 months old, hopefully this will work. Okay, here we go. So that very cute one in the middle is me. Haven't changed at all. So yeah, so this was my life in Africa. My mum, my dad, the swimming pools, the nannies, you know, a very happy, privileged life. When I was 18 months old, so very, very young, that changed. My dad was an architect. My mum was a graphic designer. And back then in Lagos, there wasn't street lights, street signs. And off my dad went to work. Said goodbye to the family, handed us over to the maids, and off he went. Within 24 hours, my dad was in intensive care. A big, massive truck had hit him head on. Massive spike going through his brain, lost his eye, and he was suddenly dying. My mum was rushed to the hospital and was told, right, we need to take him either to America or to Birmingham. You can't bring your children. You need to fly with him now. So we were left in Africa for 2 years. We were handed over to friends, we were handed over to the maids, and we were brought up with no parents from 18 months old. So obviously that was not a good start. But as young people, you are put in many, many situations. And if that's your life, you just live it. You don't think this is strange. This is unusual. We just got on with it. Now, my dad survived. My dad was left with the mental age of an 11-year-old. He was severely brain damaged, very, very, very damaged. But we all flew to England when I was 4. Now, it was very, very difficult. We'd gone from this life of luxury, and all of a sudden we were in a little semi-detached house in Bourneville, which is in Birmingham. And there was my dad, brain damaged, confused, abusive, very, very, very dangerous. And social services said to my mum, listen, the way he's treating the children, you have a choice, your husband or your children, or we'll take those children into care. My mum had a massive nervous breakdown. So she'd gone from this very successful woman. And what she did is she basically couldn't cope. And they said, you have to put him in a care home. Now, my mum met a man around the corner whose wife had just committed suicide. So, woe and behold, this is going to work, isn't it? So those two paired up together And because he was very practical and very good with children, there you go, have some children. Some parents, as long as they see their children are being looked after, they sometimes forget there's so much more. He was a very unemotional, not very loving man, but very practical. So he had all these lists of chores, these lists of, you know, how we clean things, how we do things. Off my dad went into the care home and we bought a big, massive house in Birmingham and we all moved in together. Now, when I was four, I was just confused. I had no idea what was going on. And I was this happy, bubbly little girl, full of affection, full of love, full of life, trying to hug people, trying to kiss people. So I've come back round now. That is me today. But then that's what I was like. Over the next few years, that little girl turned into an angry little girl. I just wanted a hug. Where is my mom? Where's my dad? Why is his stepdad so horrible to me? Why won't he give me a cuddle? Why won't he hug me? So I was angry. Then the angry Alison was born. How many of you work with children that are angry? That you'll go up to and they will literally just get lost. Who are you? You know, that is because they're hurting. That was me. I did not care what anyone had to say to me. I was hurt. End of. This man, I was putting my arms up to him for a hug. He was rejecting me. That wasn't okay in my mind. So off I went. Now that carried on until I was about 13 and everything changed. Knight in shining armour came and swept me off my feet at the age of 13. So again, think about that, 13. He was 19, but he loved me. He told me I was beautiful. He bought me presents. He bought my school uniform. He made me wear makeup. He used to take me to get my hair done. Can you see the pattern here? But this was the first time in my life I felt love. The first time I was hugged. So I could not care less what anyone had to say to me. I was in love. I was sorted. Didn't need anything. Didn't need anybody else. Again, you might meet people that aren't interested in what you're telling them. They seem so focused on their ideas. It's because they don't know anything differently and they're so desperately sad that any little bit of happiness they're grateful for. His name was Tony. Now, very quickly, Tony began to control, isolate me from everybody, pick me up from school. I wasn't allowed to go to netball. I wasn't allowed to wear the netball kit. But that's okay, because he loved me. He obviously cared about me, didn't he? But if I said anything different, Tony would beat me up. From the age of 13, I was in a domestic abuse relationship, going to school covered in bruises, black eyes. It was all right though, because Tony loved me. At the age of 15, I was at school, grade A student. They said, she's going to be a solicitor, she's going to be a doctor. That didn't exactly happen. Because I had Tony, what else mattered? So I was at school. Then something else happened in my life. That was my sister, my pride and joy sister, because I've got a lot of sisters and brothers, and she's my favourite, if I'm honest, Catherine. Catherine was gang raped in a park. We had to leave school under protection. I left school, didn't care. I had Tony. About 9 months later, can you see what's going to happen now? 9 months later, my daughter was born. And, you know, I had my daughter, so what else mattered? There's my daughter. So this is my daughter, Sherelle. So I was a teenage mum in an abusive relationship, neglected, and inside of me was hollow. That's the only way I can describe it. Inside of me was empty. There was nothing, there was no emotion, there was just pain. But I had Sherelle and I was doing okay. Had her when I was 15, went to college when I was 16. But then I was offered a house from, you know, a housing association. So I was like, yeah, this is exciting. I didn't know how to cope with that. Nobody had guided me in my life. How many young people are given a property and within 6 months they're almost losing it? Because we're not enabling them to learn how to deal with it. I hadn't got a clue. £400 phone bills, not paying my rent. Bills, what are they? I don't care about bills. The only way I survived at that point in my life was how I looked. I was beautiful. I was pretty. As long as I had that message in my head, I could survive. And so that is a very dangerous way to be. And as I kept saying, inside was empty. Now, when I was 18 and I got the property, I couldn't cope. And then my parents, my mum, who'd had the nervous breakdown, my stepdad, saw a massive opportunity. She's struggling and we know that we haven't done the best job. We'll offer to look after that little girl for Alison. And that way we can, you know, put all the bad things we've done to rest. So instead of giving me support, helping me, coming round and helping me deal with all these things, they didn't take my daughter, but they made it very difficult for me to have any self-esteem. The panic attacks, the dread, the fear. I'm not good enough. So they lived in this big house, used to take her on holiday, horse riding, and there's me thinking, they're better than me. So Sherelle's all right, so she can be with them. And I was just this lonely shell of a person. But my face looked nice and my hair looked nice, so it was okay. I was surviving. Now, Sherelle's dad, I left when I was 18. Don't know why, just had enough. During that period of time, he did his best to impregnate as many women as he possibly could. He was abusive, violent, and I just had enough. So I'm really proud of myself for that. I didn't stay in an abusive relationship. I was like, no, not having this. So, you know, first pat on the back for me was at that point. Then I met Joshua's dad. And with me, whenever I met somebody, there was like a tick list in my mind. Is he abusive? Does he hit me? No. Oh my God, he must be amazing. Does he kick me? No. Does he throw dirty cigarettes in my mouth? No. Oh, he must love me then. Tick, great, we'll go out with him. Problem was with Joshua's dad, he was a criminal. But that was all right because he wasn't violent, so not a problem. So, yeah, so very quickly, I was pregnant with Josh. And, oh, this computer, sorry. Yeah, so when I was 21, I was pregnant with Josh. And very quickly after I had Josh, the panic attacks came, the doubt came, the postnatal depression came, and I had this little boy that I was thinking, I'm not good enough. So who came to my rescue? Nobody. My parents came, we'll have him. Taking him on the holidays, taking him horse riding. I desperately wanted someone to say, we'll come and sit with you, Alison, we'll help you, but they didn't come. But he was being cared for, and that's all I wanted, so that was it. Very quickly, the cracks started to show. Josh was getting angry. Josh was diagnosed with ADHD, with Asperger's, with OCD, and he was an angry little boy. At that point, I knew in the back of my head why he was angry. He wanted me, but I wasn't able to process it enough to take responsibility. But then he started getting violent. At the age of 6, he thought nothing of fly kicking my mom. Which I'm not laughing, but if you saw Josh in action, it was actually quite funny. He was like Kung Fu Panda, but really small. So he'd be flying at everybody, spitting at them, horrendous. And then all of a sudden, I was looking at Josh's dad and thinking, you're a criminal. Being a criminal means you're going to be taken away from my son. I want my son to have a dad. I didn't have a dad. Oh my God, no way. Not having this relationship either. So finished with Josh's dad. So here I am, single parent. 2 children of various colours. Terrible record of choice, but I was still standing. And then I was looking at Josh and I was going to all the meetings with CAMs and everything. And I thought, you know what? They're not going to help my son because they're not really grasping it. As soon as he swore at them, we can't deal with him, he's swearing. And I'm just like, okay. I don't know what happened in my life, but all of a sudden that void inside started to little bit fill up, drip, 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 drip. I was becoming a mum. And not only a mum, I was so good. I was the best mum for Josh. And I could deal with anything. If he kicked off, I was strong enough to restrain him. If he tried to punch me in the head, I was like, what? Because I was strong, but I didn't really realise. And all of a sudden, that massive void inside was full, and I, for the first time in my life, realised something, and I realised I now know my value. I now know that I'm good. Not only good, I'm amazing. Look at me. I am the best mum ever to that little boy. And I don't know what else words to use, smashed it. Don't anybody disrespect my son. Don't anybody tell me he's naughty. He's not naughty. Okay, he might appear naughty, but I know he's in pain. The sooner we start seeing pain is a trigger to the majority of problems, the quicker we can help young people. So I was Josh's, not saviour, because I was his mum, but, you know, I did everything I could. For 4 years, Josh pushed. Children will tell you they don't care. So, ban me then, take me out of it. I don't care. They do care. They just want you to reject them because that's all they've been used to. Josh was getting the yellow pages, was phoning social services. Come and get me, my mum doesn't want me. Come and get me, my mum doesn't care. He was testing me, and oh boy, did he test me. I had tellies thrown at my head. Every single day for 4 years, he offered to knock me out. Every name under the sun, every name under the sun. When I tried to give him his medication for his ADHD, it was thrown off my head. He'd fly kick me, tried to punch me, so I became a bit of a ninja. So I was like dodging him most mornings, but I never got angry because I knew he had to express and he had to release the pain. And then all of a sudden, you could see the change in him. This big, massive cloud started to just drift. And I thought, it's working. Then his manners started to kick in. Then he started showing affection. And I'm there like, literally, like a proud peacock, like, yeah, yeah, I've done this. Look at me. I'm amazing. And I truly believe that, as you probably noticed. And that was it. Now, of course, that wasn't going to be the end of the traumas, was it? Because it's me. Now, when Josh was 13, I was sitting on the sofa. Oh, let me wind it back a bit. So I met my husband when Josh was 9, and he was a lovely guy, no violence. He actually worked, had a job, didn't drink, didn't smoke, didn't sell drugs. And I'm like, oh, and I thought, you know what? I've cracked this as well. So another tick for Alison. Good, stable, loving relationship. And that's how it stayed. I'm not going to tell you that, you know, something happened. That's how that stayed. So perfect for Josh. And then me and my husband were snuggling on the sofa, being all in love. And the news came on. Murder in Bromsgrove. Man arrested. Bang. Joshua's dad. Joshua's dad went out with a gun and killed someone. And shot someone else. And beat someone else up. And I remember staring at the TV and I dropped to the floor, howling, because I knew my son was about to have his heart broken. And I had to tell him. So, you know, cut a long story short, that came out so wrong. You know what I'm trying to say. And I brought Josh home and I had to tell him, your dad is a murderer. So what was a angry, unsettled, scared little boy went to a furious, angry young man, and he didn't care. He did not care who you were. You couldn't tell him anything. You look at him funny, he'll go to beat you up. You say anything to him, he'll fight you. He'd swear at the Pope, and I'm not joking. If he'd have met the Pope, he'd have sworn at the Pope. He was horrendous, but I saw exactly what was wrong with Josh. He was hurt through the whole of his heart because he wanted his daddy. His dad ended up getting 102 years in prison. Full-blown documentaries all over BBC One, Crime Watch special. And guess what? They're doing a documentary about him that's coming out at Christmas. Watch this space, because that'll be fun for me, won't it? But hey, such is life. And that was it. Now, from the age of 13 to 15, Josh wasn't having it. He was fighting everyone, assaulting people, getting arrested. And then when Josh was 15, the worst thing I thought could have happened happened. Joshua got sent to prison for 2 years. He was taken from me. And he was sent to a young offenders, but it was linked to his dad's case. And they'd set Joshua up and put him in prison for something he hadn't done. Because, of course, why wouldn't they? So, yeah, my son was in prison for 2 years for something he hadn't done. No way. That wasn't going to happen. So Alison the Ninja appeared and fought the whole of the, you know, court system, justice system. And I got that conviction overturned. 6 weeks later, I got my little boy home. And that was the point that everything changed, because he realised, I love my mum. All the stuff we've been through, I've got her. All it takes for young people to survive is to have one person to believe in them. They don't have to be a mom, a dad. It can be anyone. But consistency, unconditional support, not 9-to-5 support, and then you go home and they need you at 8 o'clock. It's unconditional support and love. And Josh came home. Josh very quickly started to write his emotions. Within a few months, he was touring Europe. He was flying out all over the place, all over the UK, and he started to write. Those words became lyrics. Those lyrics and over 72 million views on YouTube. And he came up to me, he goes, "Mom, I'm going to become Depp's man." I was like, "Don't know what you're talking about, Josh." He goes, "A grime MC, Mom?" I was like, "Still don't know what you're talking about, Josh." And that was it. He was happy, I was happy. Couldn't care less what he did with his life as long as he was happy. He'd processed everything. That's my dad, but that's not me. I'm loved by my mom. That's all I need. And he was conquering the world. And that sounds incredibly dramatic, but he was. He was happy, respectful, showed love, and loved me dearly. So what more could I possibly want? In July of 2003, Joshua released an album. The album was called Too Real. Within 24 hours of that album being released, I had a 6'2" little boy bouncing up and down on the bed. Josh's way of showing affection was used to fly kick me across the room and punch me in the arm and then giggle, pick me up and give me a kiss. So I was being wobbled about like a rag doll. He goes, "Mum, it's gone to number one." I said, "Oh, brilliant, Josh." And in my head, I was thinking, it hasn't, Josh. It can't have gone to number one. And then I Googled it. At number one in America was Drake. At number one in the UK was Josh, the youngest unsigned artist ever to go in the number one album. And I was so, so proud of him. And I could not care less it was number one. My little boy was happy. So I was happy. What more could I have possibly wanted? In the August of that year, Joshua celebrated his 18th birthday. Another one of Josh's talents was partying. So one birthday lasted about 8 days. Every day, like, "It's my birthday, Mum." I'm thinking, "It isn't your birthday, Josh. What are you doing for your birthday?" "I'm going to Amsterdam." And I was like, "Oh, God." "Ibiza, oh, God." And as long as he was happy, I was happy. Because as a parent, or people that genuinely care about young people, that's all you want. You want them to do the best they can do. And it could be they work in McDonald's and get 5 stars. That could be the most amazing achievement ever for that individual. You have to look at the path they've had to live and walk to get to that point. So Josh was amazing in every single way going, not because of his music, because of the fact that he was standing. He could show love, he had respect, and he knew 100% I am loved. And that's all we need. And now I'll play you the next part of it, which I know some of you are aware of. So I'll just play this part.
And that goes by the name of Kyle Sheenan. And forever, I think back. Was stabbed and murdered at the age of 16 in the Barton Green area of Birmingham. I wish you could come for a meal with us. I wish you could make a year later, his mother threw a memorial fundraiser in loving memory of her son. That day of the memorial, attending as both a performer and a close friend of Kyle, was Joshua Wybeeler. He goes by the name of Dexman, a local rapper from the Moslem Kingsley area in Birmingham. At a young age, Depp took a deep interest towards music. He started to write and record songs in a local youth centre at Hood City with childhood friends. He then met up with another friend who had his own YouTube broadcast channel called Silence TV. He started taking his talent further and branched out, featuring on other broadcast channels in Birmingham. His next step was the Conquer Grind blog, sending for a more established and older artist.
And we're featured on a lot of his music, yeah. Right now it's emotional. JK's already told you. And I've been there when his producers, when he made Too Real, we had all had an input. And when he was coming with, like, such talent, he kept me on my toes, he made me want to work, you know what I'm saying?
After mastering both channels, Grindblog and Silence TV, Depp went on continuing to work towards his goal, joining a grind team called Invasion Alert. He then went abroad and recorded music videos with his team, as well as working with the UK's most known grind channel, SBTV. Back then they didn't want to know, fam.
Now he sight say they have to. Back then, man, couldn't get a show, fam. Now in one day, I'll have to. I'm a blow in this thing, yeah, I have to. Make my mum proud and my dad too. Gotta stay on the straight and narrow. Car one day, I'm gonna be a dad too. One love to all of my family. Can't forget my granddad too. Been supporting me from the start. Ain't him off, yeah, I had to. And the man them already know that. If you got my back, then I'll back you.
One love, that is the bang. I should have got signed for that tune there, man.
That night of Carl's memorial, Depps went to perform his tribute track Reality in loving memory of Shams. During the event, an argument occurred that got out of hand. These scuffles continued both inside and outside of the event until Mitchell was asked to leave. He then later returned and was admitted entrance by the bouncers, though he had changed his hat upon arrival. Another incident occurred yet again, resulting in Depps being led outside by friends to resolve the issue. Depps was then escorted to the entrance of the car park and was fatally stabbed in the chest, causing penetration of the heart. Later on that night, Depps was brought to the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Selly Oak, where friends and family gathered to support him. Hours later, around 5 a.m, his mother returned to the waiting room of the hospital to announce that he had died from that stab wound to the chest. The whole event was covered by a range of reporters from various news channels.
A well-regarded rap artist Joshua's dreams of musical success were ended by a single stab wound to the heart outside a nightclub in Selly Oak one night in September.
Squeeze up a bit. There are still lots of people trying to get in.
By the time the service started today, it was standing room only at one of Birmingham's largest churches. The mourners spilling out into the street.
The trial had taken place and the verdict was reached. On the 27th of March 2014, Armani Mitchell was sentenced to life at Crown Court in Birmingham, with a minimum of 18 years imprisonment before he would be eligible to apply for parole.
Just a few hours before he went to the event, I spoke to him and he's saying that he got his he just got his first payment from Two Real, from the pre-orders. And he was telling me on the phone how much he'd made, and I was like, no way, fam, like, I'm proud of you. I got to tell him I was proud of him. See you tomorrow. And that was the last conversation.
So that's what happened. Now, I'll tell you what happened on the night. And this is what I do share with the young people that I work alongside and try and help. At no point do I tell anybody how to behave. I just try and show them the devastating consequences of carrying a knife. Now, Joshua went to the event on the 20th of September 2013, normal evening. He went out the door and off he went. Now, he performed his track called Reality, and a boy by the name of Armani Mitchell also attended. Josh and Armani did not like each other. You know what it's like. They're like two, you know, who's the baddest, who's the best looking. So they fronted up to each other and had an argument over a girl. Not a big argument, but Armani's pride was dented. So he kicked off. What, you think you're bad? You think you're this sick grime MC? Watch. I'll show you. I'm going to wet you up. And he left. He left the club and he went home. And then he made a choice, and that was to pick up a knife. He put the knife in his pouch and came back to the club. Now, Josh didn't think there was a problem because it wasn't a big deal. Now, on the CCTV, I try and say to the young people, you might see Depps Man. So many people know Depps Man. But Depps Man is not my son. My son is Josh. My little boy, my only son. And the person that saved me from a life of misery. So I'm talking to you about my little boy. Now, Armani cried in the trial. How many times do you meet young people and they're lovely, they're nice kids, and then you have to go to court to support them? You have to go to the police station to support them because they've made the wrong choice. Armani's not a bad person. I don't hate Armani. I have a lot of sympathy for Armani because that could have easily been Josh. How many people make the wrong choice? so many young people sitting in prison because they've lost their temper. Don't hate them. They need us. They need us to support them. Armani followed Josh with the intention of cutting him across the arm. But Josh moved. He lifted his arm up. The knife slipped. It went through two of Josh's ribs, all the way into his heart. Armani pulls the knife out and looks terrified. That wasn't supposed to happen. And he ran. I then see my son look really scared because I've had to watch the whole of that CCTV. Josh looks down at his chest and I know what he was thinking. First aid. I can do this. Because Josh thought he could do anything. Took his t-shirt off, scrunched it up, held it to the wound and ran back to the door staff. If you're stabbed in the heart, you normally bleed out within 2 to 3 minutes. Josh's eyes flicker, they close and he goes thud, straight on the floor. His friends hold his head and cradle him and comfort him. He's then put in the back of the ambulance and taken to the hospital. I went to the hospital. Three nurses were crying and said, Alison, we're working on him. I said, okay. And like I said, Josh didn't die within 2 to 3 minutes. He lived for just under 7 hours. And during that period, he had 7 heart attacks, multiple blood transfusions. And I truly believe every single time his heart stopped, he fought back because why? He didn't want to leave me behind. But on the morning of the 21st of September at 5:58 a.m, my son gave up on life and he died. And that changed everything for Josh, for me, hundreds, thousands of other people. But it also changed the life of another 18-year-old boy. And I try and say to the young people, think of him as well, because he's now serving life under 24-hour protection because he wanted to be a bad boy for a split second. I am sure Armani is not sitting in that cell going, yeah, I'm so glad I'm here. I did the right thing. He wishes he could turn back the clock, but he can't. And so many of our young people can't. And that was it. Now, the police said, listen, Alison, you can see Josh now, but his forensics. Because I didn't know this, because why would I? If somebody dies, they're not yours anymore. They become the state's until the coroner releases the body back to you. So I wasn't allowed to go near him. But after about an hour, they said, right, what we'll do, Alison, we'll take the sheet off his face and you can stroke his cheek. You can hold his hand. You can tell him how much you love him. You can kiss him, but please don't move the sheet because under that sheet are the cuts, the stab wounds, staples, machinery. I never, ever saw my son again. And that's a very difficult thing to share with young people, but I do because I want them to understand. I also explain what Joshua did growing up. And I also explain to them that as a parent, I am the luckiest person ever. And I'm sure you're all sitting there thinking, you're not love. I am. I really, really am. Firstly, I have no regrets. I always did the best I could. And that's all we can do. My son publicly showed everyone how much he loved me, but privately showed how much he loved me. He used to write me little notes saying, I love you, Mum. He used to tweet me, he used to text me. He knew he was loved. So how can I regret anything? Because that's all we all need, is to be loved and guided in the right direction. Josh was cremated because I didn't want to bury my son. I needed him with me and I still do. So I go into his bedroom and he's in a horrible purple pot and I go in there and sometimes I take him to the school, don't I, yeah? And sometimes the teachers poke and don't realise that he's in my bag. No names mentioned. But, so I go in his room and I hold him. Mother's Day, I hug my son. His birthday, I lie in the bed with him. Sometimes I go to sleep on his bed and hold him. In his ashes, and I say to the young people, Gucci pouch, Gucci trainers, an £8,000 Rolex. His room is full of Armani, Apple products. For some reason, a lot of young people seem to think that is a sign of success. But I try and show them they all have the only thing that matters. And it isn't trainers. It isn't a Gucci pouch. It's a choice. A choice to live and do the best they can do. They don't have to throw their life away with people like you supporting them. People like me guiding them, educating them. And when they all, I'm going to swear, tell you to fuck off. Okay, they've told you to fuck off. Take it. You're here to help. You're not here to judge. See it as a reaction, not a personal attack. And then you never know, their cloud could lift and you could be the key to their success. Now, I'll show This is my life now. And I say life. I'm not living, I'm surviving. But I do live in hope that that might change one day. One day, I might start to live again. I still live for my son. Because that's all I can do. I go into schools every day. I speak to about 2,000 young people a week. I go to wherever I can do to talk about Josh because I love talking about my son. So anyone wants to invite me anywhere, I'll be there because I will talk about my son. This is my daughter, my little girl who grew up to be like a mini version of me. So that's me and my daughter. And bless her, four grandchildren. Not one, not two, not three, four. So I now have four of the little rugrats. And that is what I have to do. I have to give them hope. I have to give them a future. I have to show them that things can be incredibly hard and there can be a lot of pain in the world. But don't worry, you've got me. You've got grandma, your funny, crazy little nutter of a grandma that will bounce about pretending it's happy. And as soon as the door shuts, I'll just fall on the floor and cry usually. But we can't let our pain determine the next generation. We can't put that pain onto the others. We have to leave it behind. And keep trying and keep trying. Because why do I want to hurt these four? Show them the world is a horrible place full of pain through negativity. No, I'm the crazy lunatic that goes down the slide thinking I'm about 12. And they're just looking at me like, what is this woman doing? But that is their future happiness. And that is our job. It's very easy and understandable to just give up or want to give up. And there's been days I've thought I can't. But I can and I do. And I do well, and I try my hardest. And that's all any of us can do. Keep trying, keep trying, keep trying. 2 weeks before the trial, my husband left me. Tick, another trauma. This year, my mum passed away. But, again, I was lucky. How many of us are pre-warned someone's going to die and are able to tick all the boxes? So, luckily, I managed to get away with all the guilt and all the times I was horrible to her. I shut up very quickly when she was diagnosed terminally ill. And I was like an angelic daughter. So I used that to relieve myself of any guilt. So that is okay. Very hard. Very, very hard, but okay. The loss of Josh, I don't think will ever be okay. But keep trying. And I keep trying for all these lovely people. I've been given awards. People think highly of me, which I really, really appreciate. But all it does, it gives me strength. And that is the strength to keep going. And you can give other people strength. Just coming here today, I was terrified. I was thinking, oh my God, they're coming to see me. But you've given me strength. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you for giving me your time and attention. To those I've made cry, I'm sorry, but at least we both look blotchy. And thank you very, very much for listening. I'm just going to play a really quick few seconds of one of Josh's tracks just to show you what a beautiful little boy he was.
Back then they didn't want to know, fam. Now we start to say they have to. Back then man couldn't get a show, fam. Now in one day I'll have to. I'ma blow in this thing, yeah I have to. Make my mum proud and my dad too. Gotta stay on the straight and narrow. Cause one day I'm gonna be a dad too. One love to all of my family. Can't forget my granddad too. Been supporting me from the start. Ail him off, yeah I had to. And the man them already know that. If you got my back then I'll back you. You get out what you put in. So family to put in the work I'm glad to. Stop time wasting and started learning. Stop waiting and started working. One love to the man in my circle. We're gonna make it, yeah that's for certain. One love to the haters pushing me to pick up the mic and keep working. One love to the industry people that try block man but it ain't working. Stop time wasting and started learning. Stop waiting and started working. One love to the man in my circle. We're gonna make it, yeah that's for certain. One love to the haters pushing me to pick up the mic and keep working. One love to the industry people that try block man but it ain't working.